The life of Christ is the greatest story ever told. We need to know who Jesus is, what he taught, how he lived, and what he promised. In this first lesson, we shall look at the Old Testament prophecies concerning the coming of Christ and how these prophecies were fulfilled in the person of Jesus Christ. God has always been with his people. This was something that was deeply ingrained in the faith of Israel. It was their distinction and glory. As it was in the past, so it will be in the future. The prophets proclaimed to God's people, "Fear not, for I redeem you. I call you by your name. You are mine. When you go through the waters, I'm with you. And when you go through the rivers, they shall not submerge you. When you go through the fire, you shall not be burned, and the flames shall not scorch you." Isaiah 43, verses 1 and 2. And for this to become a reality, a child was to be born to bear the name that means exactly that. The name Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us, which the full description of this hope was to be given to this child. The nearness of God given here is not to be made manifest in any other thing or place, but in a man whose nature it is to be God with us. In him and through him, God is near and present, more closely and more real than ever before. The name Jesus, which means he will save, was therefore given to Mary's son to signify that he would save his people from their sins. Linked to it through the New Testament is the title Christ, or in Hebrew language, Messiah, which means the Anointed One. At the time of the birth of Jesus, there was an intense hope among the Jews that the Anointed One was about to come and that he would be an ideal king, standing alongside an ideal high priest, or carrying both figures in one person. When Jesus asked his disciples, "Who do you say that I am?" Peter responded with a simple phrase bearing centuries of intense longing, "You are the Christ," Mark chapter 8, verse 29. The first century evangelists were well versed in the Hebrew Bible. In reading the Gospels, you will find several references to the Old Testament prophecies being fulfilled in the New Testament. The link made between the two Testaments set the stage for the presentation of the life of Jesus, which is a series we shall present to you in the coming lessons. There are over 26 Old Testament prophecies concerning the coming of Christ. We would like to look at a few major aspects of these prophecies. The events surrounding the birth of Jesus form perhaps the world's most famous and beloved story. The Gospels of Matthew and Luke agree on the major elements: the birth of the child Jesus in Bethlehem during the reign of Herod the Great, as prophesied by Prophet Micah, chapter 5, verse 2, a child conceived of the Holy Spirit and him destined to be the Savior of the world. The words of Prophet Isaiah are the most frequently cited in the New Testament to show how Jesus' life fulfilled Old Testament prophecies. We shall take Isaiah 53, verse 5 to 12 for this lesson. This is the prophecy that Apostle Peter used to remind his listeners in 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 21 through 25, saying, "Christ also suffered for you." Although he does not explicitly quote Isaiah in this brief description of Jesus' suffering on the cross, Peter revealed how the words of the prophet could be used to shape the way the story of his master's death was to be remembered. This is exactly the way the words of Psalms 22 were used by Matthew for his crucifixion. Through every book in the New Testament, this fulfillment in Christ can be traced. He is the new Israel and the new Messiah, upon whom the Spirit of the Lord is poured out. He is the descendant of David, ruling over a universal kingdom. He is the Messiah of peace, bringing justice, righteousness, and faithfulness to his people in the strength of the Lord. In some deep detail, the New Testament proclaims that he is the one expected. On page after page, it testifies that God has kept his solemn promise. Perhaps first and foremost, we should understand Jesus Christ as the fulfillment of Israel's obedience. The people of the Old Testament covenant were called to serve the Lord as his son. God brought them out of Egypt into a good land flowing with milk and honey. He gave them a law to govern their life and fought before them in their battles. He set a king to reign over them and raised up prophets to guide them. He asked only in return that they love him and trust him and let him rule their hearts and wills. He asked of his sons, Israel, surrender in order that the son might be the instrument of God's redemption of the world. But Israel could not trust the Lord or walk in his commandments. Israel was a rebellious son. God therefore replaced Israel with a new and faithful son, a son who in every respect was tempted like Israel and like we are, yet without sinning. Through the course of the gospel stories, we can trace his obedience, his refusal in the desert temptation to serve any other ruler but God, his rejection of even the closest human ties as more important than his relationship with his heavenly Father, his total subjection of man's life with man to God's will and purpose for the community, his constant refusal in his dealing with the scribes and the Pharisees to conform to mere human standards of morality and religion. In every deed and word, Jesus acknowledged the sole lordship of God until his obedience brought him finally to a dark garden called Gethsemane, where in sorrow and agony, he sweated out his last surrender. Father, if it is your will, remove this cup from me. Not my will, but yours be done. Here was the true Son of God. Here was the descendant of Abraham and of David who perfectly followed his heavenly Father. Here was the new Israel, the one of unshakable faith. Here was the obedient Israel whom God could use for his purpose. Other major prophecies fulfilled in Jesus include the following. 1. It was prophesied that Jesus would be born of a virgin as recorded in the book of Isaiah chapter 7 verse 14. This child to be born would be truly Emmanuel, God with us. This was fulfilled when a young virgin named Mary gave birth to a son whom she named Jesus, as recorded in Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 through 23, and Luke chapter 1, verses 26 through 35. 2. The time of Jesus' birth was also prophesied in the dream of King Nebuchadnezzar, which Daniel interpreted for him. It was to be during the reign of the Roman Empire, Daniel chapter 2, verse 44. Luke records that it was during the Roman reign in Palestine that Christ was born in the city of Bethlehem, Luke chapter 2, verse 1 and 2. 3. During his preaching, Prophet Isaiah saw that before Christ would come, a forerunner to prepare his way, would be born to proclaim his coming. This is recorded in Isaiah chapter 40, verse 3 and 4. Luke records that John the Baptist was born for that purpose and did preach the coming of the Messiah, whose way he was preparing. Luke chapter 3, verses 3 to 6, 4. Through the voice of Moses, God announced that he would send to Israel a prophet like Moses. This is recorded in Deuteronomy chapter 18, verses 15 to 19. The Apostle John confirms this in John chapter 6, verse 14, where the people themselves, having seen what Jesus was able to do, remarked, "Surely, this is the prophet who is to come into the world." 5. He was to be a preacher of good news to the poor. Prophet Isaiah said, as recorded in chapter 6, verses 1 and 2, Luke and Matthew records how Jesus' soul ministry was devoted to the poor in the society. Luke chapter 4, verse 18, and Matthew chapter 11, verse 5. 6. It is also recorded that his teachings will not be heard by most of his listeners. Isaiah chapter 6, verses 9 and 10. The entire section of John chapter 6 is a record of how people hardened their hearts from Jesus' teachings, and some of them even left following him. 7. The Messiah who was to come was prophesied that would begin his ministry in Galilee. Isaiah chapter 9, verses 1 and 2. Matthew records that when his time was ripe to begin his ministry, Jesus went to Galilee and began to preach about the kingdom of God. Matthew chapter 4, verses 12 to 16. 8. The ministry of the one to come as the Messiah would be a healing ministry, according to Isaiah chapter 53, verse 4. The New Testament books of Matthew and Luke are full of records of Jesus healing all sorts of ailments that were brought to him. Example are Matthew chapter 4, verse 23, and Luke chapter 6, verse 19. 9. Didn't prophet Isaiah saw works of miracles accompanying Jesus' ministry? He foretold of this in Isaiah chapter 35, verses 5 and 6, chapter 53, verses 4 and 5. Matthew chapter 8, verses 16 and 17 narrates how many demons possessed were brought to him, and he healed them all, plus all the sick, to fulfill what was spoken through prophet Isaiah concerning his carrying our infirmities and diseases. 10. When Jesus cleansed the temple in Jerusalem, as recorded in John chapter 2, verses 12 to 16, he was simply fulfilling what was written earlier in the book of Psalms chapter 69, verse 9. The zeal of his father's house consumed him. 11. When the time came for him to end his ministry, it is written that he would enter Jerusalem in triumph by prophet Zechariah in chapter 9, verse 9. John and Matthew record that the people took palm branches and went out to meet Jesus, shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." John chapter 13, verses 12 and 14, and Matthew chapter 21, verses 4 to 9. 12. The Messiah would be despised, and insults would be thrown at him. Isaiah chapter 53, verse 3. John chapter 1, verses 11, and chapter 5, verses 43, records how God came to his own who did not receive him. 13. Conspiracy against the Messiah was something prophet Zechariah saw. This is recorded in chapter 11, verse 12 and 13. And it is also recorded in Psalms 2, verses 1 and 2. Matthew chapter 26, verse 15, records how they conspired against him and sold him for 30 coins of silver. 14. This betrayal would come through the hands of a friend, says the psalmist. Psalms 41 verse 9. Mark painfully records how Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, went to the chief priest to betray him. Mark chapter 14 verse 10. 15. He would be silent before his accusers. Isaiah 53 verse 7. He didn't utter a word when they asked for his testimony before those who judged him. Matthew 26 verses 62 and 63. 16. His meeting before the Sanhedrin, the supreme Jewish court in Jerusalem, was prophesied by Isaiah in chapter 50 verse 6. Mark records how they spat on him, blindfolded him, and struck him with their fists. Mark chapter 14 verse 65. 17. It was the opening words of Psalms 22 that Jesus used to express his anguish on the cross. Matthew 27 verse 46. If at the deepest level, the early verses of Psalms 22 speaks of Christ's suffering, surely the closing verses speak of the worldwide deliverance he made possible by his sacrifice. 18. His garments would be divided. Psalms 22 verse 18. Dividing his clothes, they cast lots to see what each would get. Mark 15, 24. 19. Psalms 22 also records that he would be reviled and mocked. Verse 18. This is confirmed by Matthew 27, verse 39 and 40, saying, those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, you who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. Come down from the cross if you are the Son of God. 20. And the Messiah would die surrounded by criminals. Isaiah 53 verse 12. Matthew records that two robbers were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. Matthew 27 verse 38. 21. None of his bones would be broken. The psalmist wrote in chapter 34, verse 20. When the soldiers found Jesus already dead, they did not bother to break his bones. John says that this happened so that the scripture would be fulfilled. Not one of his bones would be broken. John chapter 19, verse 33. 22. And his body was pierced with a spear to see whether he was really dead. This was prophesied by Zechariah in chapter 12, verse 10. See John chapter 19, verse 34. 23. The place of Jesus' burial, as written by Matthew, was in the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea, who had become one of his disciples. Matthew 27, verse 57. He would be buried with the rich, Isaiah wrote in chapter 53, verse 9. 24. Matthew and Mark both record appearances of Jesus to the disciples in Galilee, and Luke and John record that Jesus was also seen in Jerusalem. This was Jesus' final proclamation on the mountain as recorded in Matthew 28, verses 16 to 20. It was prophesied that he would be raised from the dead. Psalm 16, verses 9 and 10. Compare this to Matthew 28, verse 9. The tomb was empty. Jesus was alive. Not only was the tomb empty, Jesus himself has been seen on at least 5 different occasions by more than 16 of his followers. It really was Jesus, for they recognized him and they saw his crucifixion scars. And he ate with them. On the concrete certainty of the resurrection rests the whole subsequent Christian history. Surely, nothing else can account for the fact of his being. 25. He would finally ascend to the Father's right hand. Psalm 16, verse 11. Luke 24, verses 50 to 52 make it clear that the ascension took place. This happened 40 days later, as he recorded in his sequel, the Book of Acts. 26. Jesus is finally exalted at the Father's right hand. Psalm 110, verses 1 to 7. Luke records this exaltation in chapter 22, verse 69. Apostle Paul encourages Christians that the power of God exercised in raising Christ from the dead and setting him in supreme control of the universe is at work in us. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 20. Just as Prophet Isaiah said earlier, his suffering was not for his own, but for you and I. His flawless life proved that he was indeed God among us. If we believe that there is a God, then he must be the moral standard of his universe. His nature and his will must determine what is right and wrong. Obedience to him is more important than all jobs and money in the world. Jesus Christ is unique. His life was prophesied in detail by Bible prophets centuries before he was born. The Old Testament actually includes about 6 different prophecies with more than 300 references on the fulfillment of these prophecies that Israel was told that she would be able to recognize the true Messiah when he came. The 4 Gospels record several times when Jesus said that he was the fulfillment of the Old Testament prophecies, and that makes this lesson a very vital part of the study of Jesus' life and ministry. Thank you for watching this episode on the Old Testament prophecies concerning Christ. Join me in the next lesson as we look at the geography of Palestine during the time of Jesus.